Hello, everyone, and good evening. Welcome to Breaking the Political Glass Ceiling, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Shelter Rock, where we aspire to be a loving religious community, where we can grow spiritually and grow and build a more just and joyful world. This TGIF event is sponsored by Shelter Rock's Women's Group, which believes that getting women into political office is crucial for the advancement of issues challenging women today. Although women have increased their political activity, there is still a continued underrepresentation of women in political life. As of 2015, women hold only 20% of the seats in Congress and less than 25% of the seats in the New York State Legislature, 26th in the nation. How can this be changed? So our speakers tonight, Jamie Franke, Joan Maneri, and Linda Mejias. Jamie Franke is the executive editor of Mori Publishing, where she covers education and contributes news and entertainment pieces for the Long Island Press, along with occasional op-eds when she's in the mood for some hate mail. Her work can also be found on Salon.com, Milieu Magazine, The Huffington Post, and The New York Times. She is a contributor to the award-winning anthology, Love Her Not, The Hillary Paradox, and These Winter Months, The Late Orphan Project. Ms. Franke attended Dowling College and Hofstra University. She is the mother of two beautiful children and the cutest dog in the world. She enjoys arguing on Facebook with people who have the wrong opinions. She says that, like Will McAvoy, the character on Aaron Sorkin's HBO show, The Newsroom, she is on a mission to civilize. Okay, and I want to add, it was one of Ms. Franke's articles that I drew on for the title of this event, Breaking the Political Glass Ceiling. Okay, Joan Maneri is the executive director of the Unitarian Universalist Beach Program at Shelter Rock, a charitable giving program that is dedicated to affecting social change. Ms. Maneri provides stewardship of the congregation's philanthropic mission to support a broad range of denominational and non-denominational activities throughout the United States that reflect the principles and philosophy of Unitarian Universalism. Ms. Maneri brings 30 years of experience to the table as a social justice organizer and educator, and someone who is passionate about working together for the greater good. She is one of the founders of Voices Heard. She is the recipient of a number of prestigious awards, including the Ford Foundation's Leadership for a Changing World Award and the Charles H. Revson Fellows for the Future of the City of New York Award. Ms. Maneri was previously the National Program Director for the Community Learning Partnership, where she developed academic and community partnerships to foster career opportunities for low-income individuals and students of color. She is the co-author of the award-winning book, Tools for Radical Democracy, How to Organize, pardon me, Tools for Radical Democracy, How to Organize for Power in Your Community, that deals with increasing democratic participation through community organizing and the development of locally led issue campaigns. It is a tome. There is nothing that isn't in this book. Okay. Attorney Linda Mejias, for the past eight years, has been the principal law clerk to New York State Supreme Court Justice Edward Maron. Is that how he pronounces it? Maron. Active in her community and church, Ms. Mejias is passionate about teaching young women to achieve balance and their full potential by developing themselves in all aspects of their lives. She also works within minority communities through organizations such as the Long Island Latino Teachers Association, GIRLS, and the Latina Moms of Long Island to teach students and parents the necessity of higher education and the importance of working hard in any employment in order to achieve the American dream. Ms. Mejias is past president of the Nassau County Women's Bar Association and past president of the Hispanic Bar Association. She is active in the Nassau County Bar Association, where she is working to develop programs to increase the diversity of the association. She also serves proudly on the board of Her Story Writers Workshop, which is an organization that Women's Group has also sponsored. Ms. Mejias has received numerous citations for her achievements in both the legal and local communities. She has been named a rising star by the New York State Women's Bar Association, Attorney of the Year by the Cuban Civic Association, a Woman of Distinction of 2015 in the 17th Assembly District. She received the Nassau County Bar Association's Virginia Duncombe Award and was honored by the Long Island Hispanic Bar Association for her empowerment of the Hispanic community. Ms. Mejias is a first-generation American whose mother emigrated from Ecuador and whose father was exiled from Cuba as an anti-communist leader. She is also a devoted mother to her treasured son, Davy.
Hello?
Hello. Okay. I'm Jamie Frankie. I'm executive editor of Mori Publishing, which means I handle all the corporate content on our marketing side. But I'm also a reporter for the Long Island Press. So I straddle church and state. I write for the corporate side, and I'm also a journalist, and there the two shall meet. We decided that we're not going to talk about statistics and numbers tonight. We're going to tell stories. I don't like to listen to statistics, and my eyes glaze over when we start talking about numbers. And I'm not good at it. I'm better at stories. That's why I'm a writer. So we're going to tell you a few things, some people we met, and things we think are important. So along my on my education beat, I mostly write education articles for the Long Island Press. I had heard a lot about this woman, Zephyr Teachout, a couple of years ago. And I didn't really pay attention because she was challenging Andrew Cuomo in the Democratic primary for governor. And I met Andrew Cuomo, and he's a formidable guy. And he's very powerful, he's very intimidating, and I would never challenge him in anything. So Zephyr Teachout was this long shot progressive woman from Vermont with a funny name, and I didn't pay attention. But eventually I did, because she made a name for herself, and she just kept at it. And I followed her on the campaign trail, and a lot of the teachers' unions started to support her, because Andrew Cuomo's opponent, Rob Astorino, started running on the anti-Common Core platform. And a lot of teachers, a lot of parents, and activists wanted to support anti-Common Core. And they felt that Andrew Cuomo had been very punitive and politically against education. But they didn't really want to vote Republican. They didn't really support Rob Astorino. So Zephyr came along, and she was like this breath of fresh air. And she was like earnest, smart, and she's like the opposite of cynical, if I could describe her. She was, wrote a book about, you know, she's going to change corruption in New York. And I met her, and I was like, this is New York, you know, like, Florida has orange juice, like, we have corruption, like, what are you talking about? But she meant it, and she's serious, and, you know, we thought, like, just dismiss her out of hand because there's no way she's going to get anywhere. But as you know, she got, I won't give you numbers, but it was 30-something percent of the vote against Andrew Cuomo, which was really, really significant. And she got him to come out against fracking, and she did what protest candidates do. She moved him left, and she held him accountable to things that he hadn't been before. She gave him a run for his money, and it was interesting to watch. And I like her. So in the spring, after she had lost that election, She was giving a talk in a hotel ballroom, and it was about getting educators to run for local office. And I went to see her because that's my beat, education, and I like her. And she was talking about a few things, and she touched upon this one moment that stuck in my head. And she said that she was on a G-chat, like a instant message app, with somebody from the Working Families Party, and they were talking about Andrew Cuomo. And Zephyr said, somebody should challenge him for governor. Someone should challenge him in the primary. And this Working Families Party person, that she won't tell me who it is, said to her, well, yeah, and we think it should be you. And her first reaction, her immediate gut response was, I would never dare. How dare I? And she went on with the event, but that struck me as like such a female response, right? Like, I recognize that, I felt that. I want to speak on this panel? Like, who am I? How dare I? You know, and it was very human, but it was uniquely female. And it kind of brought me through into this idea of to really look into what makes women decide to run for office. This is a brave thing. It's brave in New York. In New York State, where women dominate in every part of career life. We kill it in real estate, in law, we run nonprofits, we run corporations, but not in elected office. We're very underrepresented. So it's brave, it's interesting. So I talked to Zephyr a lot about that, and she kind of piqued my interest on this topic. After I spoke with Zephyr, I called up my favorite politician in the whole wide world besides Joe Biden, Carolyn McCarthy. And she was, it was just the end of her time in Congress. And I asked her, you know, what made you run? And Carolyn McCarthy is interesting, right? She was not a career, she didn't start as a career politician, right? She started as an advocate for gun violence prevention because her husband was shot and killed by Colin Ferguson in 1993 in the Long Island Railroad. Her son Kevin was severely injured. And she was an RN. And Governor Mario Cuomo, called her up. You should run for Congress. She said, oh. And then he called her again, said, you should run for Congress. She said, no. And she did what women do. Women have to be asked to run for office. We don't say, when I grow up, I'm going to be president. Maybe some of us do. But usually it starts small. It starts at a local office. And it starts over a lunch where somebody says, we've been looking at you. We're looking at your qualifications. We think you should run for this seat. And then a woman says no. And according to NPR, it takes a woman 14 times. She has to be asked 14 separate times to run for office before she'll consider it seriously. She has all those oppositions. Sheryl Sandberg calls that imposter syndrome, right? That women have this thing where no matter how accomplished we are, no matter how much recognition we have, awards, we're just waiting for the person to like figure out that we're a fraud, you know, that we've been faking it all along, we're doing a great job and just putting up a front, and somebody's gonna find out that we don't know what the heck we're talking about, and you know, some man is gonna come take our job. Now, I generalize, but only because it's 100% true. So Carolyn McCarthy, you know, she had that, and she said, I'm a registered nurse, I'm taking care of my son, I have responsibilities. But eventually, they broke her down. They said, you're already doing the work. You're an advocate. You're well-versed on this issue. You know, you're more than capable of doing the job. And she ran, and she held office for 18 years? I don't know. Something like that. And she made changes that were important to her, important to all of us. And she spoke for, you know, her main issue, which was gun violence prevention. And she, you know, is still working, even though she's out of office, she's still working to for universal background checks on guns at the federal level. And an interesting note was when I spoke to her, it was the day after that shooting in South Carolina. That was that hate crime. The gunman went in and he shot all those people in that church. And as I was talking to her, she got emotional. And we were on the phone. I have it recorded. And like church bells started ringing as soon as she spoke about it. And it was such a moment. And I think that's how women really start. You feel something important. You feel you want to do something. And you get behind it. And something she told me was, you know, you have to trust yourself. You have to trust that you can do it, and you have to dare. She also told me that when she was in Congress, it was the first time she ever made equal pay to a man, because everybody gets paid the same salary. And I got to ask her, you know, what's the most difficult part of campaigning? And she said it was asking for money. She said fundraising. She says, you know, again, I generalize because it's true, but men have a much easier time asking for money. Women have a much easier time giving money. You know, we'll do a favor, but we're not comfortable asking for a favor. You know, I'll help you, but I have a hard time asking you to help me. Text you to watch my kids, but I'm not going to ask you face to face. So she said she eventually grew brave, and she'd hold these dinners, and people would give her, you know, donate to her campaign. And then she went up to them and said, is this how much you would give a man? They write another check. You're right. She said, it's okay. You got to advocate for yourself, because no one else is going to do it. You know, feel comfortable. You deserve your place at the table. I spoke to Carolyn McCarthy. I also spoke with Kathleen Rice. And she said the same thing when she was asked to run for district attorney. You know, people said she was crazy, that nobody in Nassau County had ever held that office. And people laughed at her. She ended up beating the incumbent, Dennis Dillon. He was in office, I think, 30 years? And now she ended up taking Carolyn McCarthy's seat in Congress. And who's behind her? Two women ran for her seat, Madeline Tsingus and Kate Murray. And she, you know, she shattered that ceiling, and she paved the way for these other women to come up behind her and to do a good job. Another thing I learned, and here's something like, you know about yourself, but it's interesting when you hear your heroes say it and you realize how human they are. You know, she said, women think we have to do a perfect job. You know, if you're told to say to run for an office or any kind of position, well, I don't know if I'm perfectly qualified. I don't know if I'm the absolute best person to ever hold this job in the history of the universe. Where, like, maybe a man would say, yeah, I could do that. And then you just get in and you figure it out and you do it. And a woman is absolutely capable of figuring it out and getting it done. That's what we do. That's who we are. You know, Louis C.K. just said that about Hillary, right? We need a mom in office. You know, mom in the Oval Office, because they get it done. They know how to get it done. And they're not going to stop until it's done. Who else? Oh, Michelle Schimmel, right? She's your local legislator here. And she said that when she was asked to run, and she, again, she was somebody who was advocating for the gun issue. And she was instrumental in passing the assault weapons ban. And she's just making a ruckus in Albany. And her, was the town of Hempstead supervisor, I don't know, said to her, why don't you run? Why don't you run for the assembly? And she said she went home and she threw up. And she said, no, how dare I? She's been doing, I think, 22 years, and she's a force. She's getting it done. So to me, I guess the moral of that story is just dare. How dare I? Just dare. Just do it. And Kathleen Rice told me, just say yes. Say yes to everything. No matter what they ask you, James, just say yes, and then you figure it out. All right. So here we are. So yes. So just say yes. Just dare. And also now, like, realize when a woman is running for office, whether it's a local school board, whether it's for the assembly, whether it's for a state senate or a senator or president, you don't vote for them because they're a woman. That's not all it takes. But what you can do is understand what it took for them to do that. Know that they had to be asked 14 times before they ever allowed themselves to believe that they were worthy enough to stand up and to say, can I have your vote? So maybe listen to them, give them that time, and understand that what it took for them to get there, that what they have to offer.
That was great. So thanks, Palma, for inviting me to participate in this. Thank you for reading my book. That's a pretty epic achievement. It's not a page turner. It's really a how-to book about community organizing, and that's really what I would like to spend a little bit of time sharing some stories from the organizations that are funded by the Unitarian Universalist Veach program. That's a faith in action program here at Shelter Rock. We fund programs all over the country where women are breaking barriers in some in electoral politics, but I wanted to talk more about ways that women that we see across the field of community organizing and social justice and social change breaking down barriers to really being full participants in social and political life. That's the kind of work that we see every day. And I think for all the stories of barriers and of ceilings, we are really privileged in our work to hear a lot of good news, because there are powerful women all over the country, in all corners of the country, and including here in New York and on Long Island, who are doing this work every day and doing it very well and very successfully. So I wanted to share some stories of how some of the women that are represented in the groups that we fund through the Veach program are breaking barriers to full participation in political and social life. And I want to, I thought it would be helpful to think about this in terms of some of the issues that they're working on as also being issues that directly affect women and that are about the participation of women in the community, not just individuals who are successful in their work or in gaining access, but really thinking about women as workers and in communities who are also breaking barriers and becoming full participants in social and political life because they come together and work for policies and practices that impact larger groups of women. And what we see is in terms of the issues that keep women from full participation would be childcare, equal pay, which, you know, you talked about Carolyn McCarthy's experience of that, and protections at work, so that when women are actually in the workforce, that they're protected as workers. And so I'm going to just highlight a few stories from those areas of advocacy and organizing and successful women working on behalf of women in childcare, equal pay, and worker protections. And so the first woman that I wanted to talk about is a woman named Ai Jen Pu, who is the head of something called the National Domestic Workers Association and an organization called Caring Across Generations. And I first got to know Ai Jen as an organizer. I've been here at the Veach program all of 2 months. I'm only here for a very short period of time. But I've been in the field, as Palma mentioned, for many, many years as an organizer, as a trainer, as a mentor. And I got to know Ai Jen when I was working in a training center for community organizers based in New York City, and she was an organizer in a Chinatown-based organization called CAV, Organizing Asian Communities. And in her work as an organizer in the community, she was one of a team of organizers who started to understand the impact of a lack of worker protections for women who did domestic work. And so, you know, most people know it's the work of care. And as Ai Jen likes to say, it's the work that makes all other work possible. So when we talk about breaking any kind of ceiling, we're talking about some women needing to hire other women to help care for their children, to help keep the house clean, and to help make the engine run. And one of so the work of the National Domestic Workers Association and IGEN's leadership in this really raises up the culture of care as work that some women do, so that other women can be in the positions of that through which they can realize their own human potential. And I think one of the really wonderful things about watching the development of the National Domestic Workers Association over all these years, and I would say it's about 15 years of work that's leading to, you know, really pretty significant victories around the country. The work of domestic workers, who are primarily women workers, is not recognized by the National Labor Relations Board. And so those workers are completely underneath any kind of worker protections. Very vulnerable, you know, some well-treated, as we all know, but many not receiving pay, not being trained, and just always vulnerable to being fired, not having benefits. And so I think one of the things that the National Domestic Workers Association has done is raised it up as in the culture of care, of really being with women where they are. Many of the women themselves are mothers who are caring for other people's children, while someone's caring for their children. It's a high, kind of like a whole cycle of care that holds the community together. And so in any kind of a gathering or a political education time with women in this organization, it's both like, you know, beautifully from the heart and very much about what this really means, about people caring for one another and having that be our work. And it's also, you know, really tough. I mean, IGEN is in there organizing, working alongside unions, being in very predominantly male spaces, moving this agenda of domestic workers. And so I think it's something that we see across many of the organizations and many of the successful organizers, but then also the women who are part of those communities who are coming forward to demand their rights. It's this combination of both from the heart, being present to one another, understanding all of the stories and the traumas and the experiences that people bring to the moment of needing to be full participants in political life, and then getting out there and fighting and winning and standing in these very tough political environments and really demanding what they need in order to be represented in electoral politics, to have labor policies that protect them and make sure that they get their wages, that they get their training, and that they have a future for coming out of a low-wage job. So IGEN Poo and the National Domestic Workers Association, I think, is an amazing example of women working with women to break barriers on all kinds of levels to full participation in political life. The other example, actually the story starts here on Long Island, with Sara Jayaraman, who was an organizer in the early, mid-1990s, with an organization here on Long Island in Hempstead called the Workplace Project. It's an immigrant workers center. She was a young lawyer, and she was, you know, doing programs here with workers in the Workplace Project around doing litigation when people weren't able to get their pay or when they had like worker grievances. But when I first met Saru, it was just after 9/11. And all of the workers who worked, there were many restaurant workers who were killed in the windows on the world when the World Trade Center collapsed. And then there were also many workers who were not at work that day, who were very vulnerable, paycheck to paycheck, immigrants who no longer had jobs. And the union that had represented them really had nowhere to turn and really didn't know what to do in terms of helping these many. I mean, it's a huge establishment, a huge employer. And the union turned to the Workplace Project for some help to figure out how to help these workers. And when I met Saru, she came to a training center that I was running again for community organizers. And she said, you know, I'm a lawyer. I don't know what to do, you know. We have to help these workers, and it's not just about winning back pay or making sure if the owner opens a new restaurant that they get a job. There's a bigger issue here. And what she has really pointed to now over, again, a long period of advocating with workers, writing about their experiences. She's written two books. One is called Behind the Kitchen Door. The other is called Forked. These like really tough books about like what the restaurant industry is really about. Is that there's, you know, there's 10 million restaurant workers in our country, and 70% of them are women. And many of them live, I think her statistic is 30% of restaurant workers live below the poverty line, and 3/4 of them rely on food stamps. So we're talking very, very, very poignant statistics about women who are restaurant workers, who are not, who receive a sub-minimum wage of $2.13 an hour. So that's what the people that we are, you know, in restaurants, or when you hear about people who are fighting now in the fight for 15, which is a kind of a, have people heard about this, that they're trying to get a $15 an hour wage. So it's gotten a lot of momentum and a lot of momentum in the political arena, but that doesn't apply to restaurant workers. They still make $2.13 an hour and rely on tips. And so these are the workers that SARU and the Restaurant Opportunity Center, or ROC, is organizing. And again, just I think a really powerful example of a woman who speaks from the heart, is very present, and is very clear about that her own ability to break barriers in the social and political arena is also around building the power of women who are working in restaurants and in food service all over our country, who are full-time workers who are poor. And so these are powerful issues, and again, women at the forefront breaking other kinds of barriers besides running for political office, which is, you know, certainly, I think, one type of important way to be politically involved, but there's all these other ways as well. And the third woman that I wanted to point to briefly is a woman that I know quite well. Her name is Sandra Collette, and we talk about her in the book that Palma mentioned. She's a leader of an organization that I helped to start in the late 1990s, called Community Voices Heard. And it is an organization that was started by women on public assistance who were being cut off of welfare during the first Clinton administration. And Sandra was a woman who relied on public assistance to make ends meet. She was a single mom. And she was, the legislation was forcing women who received public assistance to work for 40 hours a week in exchange for about $200 a week in welfare benefits. So the program is Workfare. It was very prominent in New York City under Mayor Giuliani when we were starting this organization. And Sandra Collette was one of the women who relied on this program to feed her family, who was now being required to go or to work 40 hours a week in exchange not for a wage but for a benefit. And Sandra became one of many powerful women in that organization that I came to know through working with her on a board of directors, helping to form that organization, going out and asking places like the Veach Program at Shelter Rock for money so they could do their work, and really, you know, really becoming a force of nature around these issues. And the last thing I would say about all of these examples, the Restaurant Opportunity Center, or ROC, Community Voices Heard, and the National Domestic Workers Association, is the other thing that these very powerful, savvy, sophisticated women, and the women that they're organizing in the base that they represent, do is, in addition to setting up a 501c4 or C3 organization, a nonprofit that functions as a nonprofit organization and does nonpartisan political work, they also now start C4 organizations. So it's an IRS designation that basically says, well, you don't get a tax. If I give you money for your C4 organization, I don't get a tax deduction, and then you can do what you want with it politically. You can run candidates for office. You can, you know, you can promote people from your membership to run for office. You can endorse candidates. And it's a development in the field over the last 10 years or so that I think is really powerful, really important, and a really good thing to know about if you're looking to support the work of women like SARU or iGen or Sandra or any number of organizations in the field, is that they have the work that's nonprofit. You get tax deductions for contributing to it. They can get money from foundations and from funding sources like the program here. But then individuals can give these women and really anyone who's doing this work the money to act politically and directly in the political arena. and completely above the law and in compliance with the law. So it's powerful, you know, they're doing the nonprofit work and they're also in the political arena. So, you know, I think that there's lots of bad news out there, but this is really good news. And I think it's very under the radar kind of activity that we have the privilege of working with all the time. And those are the stories that I wanted to share with you tonight. Thank you.
Hi, so I'm Linda Mejias. I am a law clerk in Supreme Court. I ran for judge last year, district court in Oyster Bay. I'm the wrong party for that town, but I came very close. I beat my running mate by several thousand votes, and I actually came pretty close, which was pretty incredible. It's interesting because I had been asked to run for that judgeship in the past, and I said no. And then I was asked again, I said no. And then I was asked to run, for Senate against Kemp Hannon, I said no. I was asked to run for my brother's former legislative seat, and I said no. So, you know, it is very interesting to me how many times we do have to be asked. My brother didn't have to be asked to run for legislature. He basically said, you need a Latino, you should run me. And I thought to myself, wow, that's some cojones on that guy, you know. So my story is really my own story in the political realm. You know, so my brother is the vice chair of one of the vice chairs of the Democratic Party in Nassau County. He's been very active in politics since I was 16. So I was very active doing politics and working on campaigns since I was very little. And, you know, I've kind of grown up in the process. I'm 37 years old now, so that's more than half my life knocking on doors, making phone calls, doing mailings. I don't ask for money because I don't like to ask for money. So when I ran for judge, that's the beauty of running for judge. You're not allowed to ask for money. But my brother had no problem doing that. And so all these phenomena, you know, I think about them and they are generalizations, but they're true. So, being in the Democratic Party, you would think that they would be more progressive. There was women in leadership and, you know, you'd have more women making decisions and more running more women candidates. False. It was only a few years ago that we started to have some women in leadership positions, but they're not always in the room. And when they are in the room, they don't always necessarily get equal voice. And I remember kind of basically threatening my brother that we need to have more women in leadership positions. And if you don't make sure that there are women in there in those rooms, I'm going to make myself put myself in that position, and you don't want to deal with me in that room. So now we do have some women leaders, but, you know, one of the things that I think about is, you know, us putting ourselves out there. And a big problem for me and why I said no so many times was because I'm a mom and I didn't want to have to travel to Albany and I didn't want to have to do this. And I also thought to myself, and I have these moments where I think, who am I? You know, I'm like this little Latina girl, first generation. What do I have to offer? And you know what? I do have a lot to offer. I know every woman in this room has a lot to offer. And we're moms, we're sisters, we're daughters, we have experience. We think about things and we think about life in a very different way. And my mom is, my mom is from Ecuador. She's a feminist in her own right, very much so. My dad died when I was 5, and she raised me and my brothers by herself. And she had no problem fighting with whoever she had to fight with. And she would say, you know, English is her second language, and she didn't really have a chance to study it, that the Holy Spirit would take her over and she'd be able to speak English when she needed to speak English. So she was a fighter, and she instilled in me, and even more so than in my brothers, that education is important, and you can do whatever you need to do. You work hard and put yourself out there. And I didn't grow up thinking that I'm a girl, so I can't do this. I can't be a lawyer. I can't be a doctor. I can't be all these things. But as I got older, I started to realize that a lot of women do get that message that, you know, get married. And I went to Wellesley, so you would think that every woman who went there, especially my generation, was thinking, like, I'm going to be this powerful woman and I'm going to do all this. And a lot of them were thinking, I just want to get married to a guy from Harvard and you know, or from MIT and kind of have a good life. And that's good too. Like, you know, in Lean In the book, we don't want to judge other women for their choices, but, you know, we want to be able to have choices. And one of the things that I've encountered over the years, and it's been a lot of hard work, is that despite all of that, we want to make political change. We want to be able to run for local office. But running for office is not just about, you do get picked if you are an advocate and you're a prominent and you're out there, but you have to kind of play the game and you have to understand the game. And right now, it's a man's game. I refuse to play the game like a man. I'm a woman and I do things my way. And all these years, I've maintained my integrity, and you have to decide what's right for me and what's not right for me. And I've been able to maintain my integrity, and I am, you know, I consider myself a woman of faith, and I have a higher power that I need to answer to. So I've made that very clear, and I make it very clear in whatever political meetings I'm in or whoever I'm with that, you know, I will do certain things, I won't do certain things, but I make sure I'm in the conversation. And I don't do things that I don't think are necessarily right for me just to get the nomination, just to be involved. And over the years, it's actually worked to my benefit, because I see a lot of, you know, some women who wanted to play the game like the boys, and they kind of fall by the wayside. And the women who have really just maintained their integrity and maintained their voice and their womanhood, they've stood the test of time, and they're my role models. You know, they do things their way. It's different, but they get it done. So that's basically was my message was that when dealing in politics, I just think that we want to do things a little bit differently. Like, we're women, we should be genuine and maintain our voice, maintain our integrity. But one of the things that, well, with the theme around here, is that we should be involved. We should be involved in our communities. That's how we get to know what the issues are. That's how people get to know us. You want to run for office, people need to know you. They need to see that you're out there. I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm very turned off when, you know, I have somebody running for office who just all of a sudden shows up. And they've never done anything for anybody. They've never helped anybody. But all of a sudden, they want to, like, you know, they want to run things. And it's usually a man. Sorry. But they just show up. And then I'm going to vote for the person who I see is out there on school board, on, you know, village elections, whatever local elections. I look for the people who have been active in their communities. And, you know, like she said earlier, was, you know, we like to give. We don't like to ask for anything. And I think that that's something that women can use for their benefit, which is, you know, we give and people take notice. People see that we want to do good things for the community, and when we do decide to finally run for office, they will back us because they know where our hearts are and that we genuinely want to make change. It's not just that you know, we want to have the prestige of being a senator, an assemblyman, a congresswoman, you know, that we want to do things. So and one thing that I, yesterday we had a Hispanic bar board meeting, and we had the past presiding judge, justice of the first department. And one thing that he said, and this was about organizing Latinos, but it's, you know, I equate it the same way, the same tactics for women, was you have to believe it. Believe that you can, believe that you will, and you will. You know, we doubt ourselves and we think we're not going to be able to do it. I'm an imposter. But we have to believe it, own it. And I tell, you know, I mentor a lot of young girls, and I say to them, you know, if you're good at something, own it. If you suck at something, own it. You know, you're good at stuff, you're bad at stuff, it's great. But we should be proud of what we're good at, and we shouldn't hide those things. You know, that was one thing that we learned at Wellesley, was when we, you know, you raise your hand and you qualify everything you say with, I'm sorry, but, you know, our professors were very clear, like, no, if you have an opinion, express it, you know, not necessarily politely, but respectfully, and you don't have to qualify every single thing that you say. So kind of going a little off tangent, but this has just been my experience of being able to rise up in politics, in associations, and kind of break through these barriers, because I am a first generation. I am a petite Latina woman, single mom. I have like all these labels on me. And when I walk into a room, I don't think of that. I think, what do I have to offer this group? I have a lot of experience. I have a big mouth. I have a lot of ideas. And I express them. And I think that's something that I want to impart to younger women, is that they should be comfortable expressing themselves, be comfortable with being intelligent, be comfortable with being vocal, and, you know, I don't let anybody interrupt me when I'm talking, especially men. I don't let them do that. So that's a big thing that I'm working on towards mentoring young women. So Girls Inc., for instance, is an organization that I'm very active with, because this is our next generation. We have kids coming up who don't care about politics. They don't care about issues, you know. Even me, I grew up in what, the 80s, 90s, like major things going on. You know, like my dad was an anti-communist leader. He was dealing with that in his lifetime. My mom, you know, wasn't allowed to go to school. Different things that I didn't necessarily grow up in. I look at my son, he's got life pretty good. He's got every type of electronic device. He's allowed to go to school. He has lunches. He's comfortable. So I want to encourage young people to get active, to get motivated, to be out there, and especially women to empower themselves, especially politically. So the last thing I wanted to just say is that, you know, and women, right, women have a better, we're a better take on this right now than, for me, the Latino community, which is organization, right? Being organized. Getting organized equals power. The more women you have working together towards a goal, then the bigger the voice that you're going to have, be able to get the ear of the governor, of policymakers. So that's another thing that I just wanted to leave you with. Thank you.
Thank you to all three of our speakers. We've heard some familiar issues: education, gun control, equal pay, childcare, worker protections. And we remember that women's rights are human rights. They're not just women's rights, they're human rights. And we've had some familiar ideas: women working with women, realizing one's own potential, speaking from the heart. So we are open now to questions. You don't have to come up to the mic if you stand up in your seat and speak loudly. Let's hear it.
I just read a similar article on this topic by Senator Gillibrand. And she mentioned that two things that women need to prove. One is competence, and two is that they have to be likable. And that's the likable part is something the men don't have to prove. So I just thought you might want to comment on how likable you think that how women have to work on being likable. I think that's been a problem for Hillary.
Yep.
A big one. But I thought maybe you want to comment about that.
Well, okay, so for example, in my party, I do notice that the women who are extremely confident, extremely competent, but a little bit of a squeaky wheel, you would say, they don't get the respect. They don't get put first in line for nominations and things like that. It's the likable, get along women who are also competent. Well, I would say that sometimes they're not even as competent, but they're more likable, like you said. And I just had on the Wellesley Facebook page, they put together a video. It's like, and the video is, I'm unlikable. And they go through and they say, you know, I'm unlikable, I'm a bitch, I'm bossy, I'm all these things. And they wrote, and they like, and what that really means is, I'm competent, I'm intelligent, I'm stern, I'm firm, all these things that exactly that men don't have to necessarily have to deal, they don't have to deal with that. I don't know, I kind of think that being likable is not necessarily a bad thing. I like being a nice person, I like treating people well, and it kind of goes hand in hand. But you know, when you have to be firm, a woman being firm and a man being firm, they're perceived very, very differently. Nasty versus a man is just being a man. You know, he's confident, right? And we're just being, yes. So it's not nice. I think it's nice to be nice. But sometimes you can't always be nice. You got to stand up for yourself.
I can add to that.
A couple of years ago, many years ago, I read an article about women always smiling and they shouldn't. This was when the women movement was in its infancy. And I happened to be working. So when I went to the office, I decided I would watch and see how the women behave. And sure enough, the women are always walking around and the guy shows up and it's smart. It's always smile time, and they're always smiling. And I thought, this is ridiculous. But then on the other hand, looks matter. I mean, I just heard criminals who are better looking get lighter sentences. So talk about likable.
I think for women, likable is equated to pleasing. Right? And it's a weakness and it's a default. And when we're not pleasing, I do it. It's an affront. And that's something that we have to overcome.
If you look at Hillary, she's always smiling. She really is. And you look at Trump, he looks. But one thing I did want to ask, you're talking about women in politics. Are you necessarily in favor of someone because they're in the Democratic Party or the Republican Party or because they're women against a man? Because there's an example right now in politics, there's a Democrat as a male and the Republican Party as a female. Now, do you advocate because she's a female?
Is it male?
No, I'm talking about Haber and Phillips. Do we go for the person because they're a Democrat, or do we go for the person because it's a woman?
So interesting. When we talked earlier, it's difficult because who do you vote for, right? So you have to look at what their politics are and see who the individual is. I'm not going to vote for you just because you're a woman. The same way, I'm a Latino, I wasn't going to vote for Cruz. I'm not going to vote party line. I think that's silly. You need to vote for the person. And that's why it's so beautiful that in this country, you have all this information available to you about all these candidates, and you can have an open dialogue about their qualifications and how they'll be in office. So, I guess it's like an individual thing, but there are some people who will only vote for women, only vote for Latinos, only vote party line. There was one year where the judges, it was all female judges. There was one male judge, but his name is Dana. So he was it didn't go by party. It went by only women won judgeships that year. I forget what year, maybe 2008, I want to say. And he was the only male that won, but it was because his first name was Dana. So it just goes to show you. He just retired, actually.
You talked about why women don't run. What do you do when you find women who you know will be good candidates, but they tell you, no, they can't because they have kids, they have this, they have that? What strategies do you use to convince them?
You start counting and you ask them 14 times.
I think that's really it. You got to just be persistent. You have to break down all their objections. Can't because you're a mom. Here's a mom running. She's doing it. We'll watch your kids. We'll figure it out. What's your next? What now? And then I asked Zephyr, how did you finally overcome that? And she said it got to a point where it was too good an opportunity to pass up, and she just felt she could do a good job. And that's what it is. You don't have to do a perfect job, but can I do a better job than that guy? Do I have something to offer? The answer is yes. Then it's almost your duty to do it if you can.
I tend to vote for the moderate person, the more moderate person, or I consider the saner person. I don't vote party, I don't vote sex, I don't vote color. It's the one that I think is going to consider a lot of different things and not act in some kind of a very hasty way. When I saw Nixon say, you're not going to have Richard Nixon to push around anymore, that kind of put a chill in me, and I said, this is not somebody that I can support. And I just wanted to give you a quote. Andrew Jackson, our president, said, one man, but I'm going to change it, one person with courage can make a majority. And that's how I've lived my life, as much as I possibly can. And if each of us can do this, or encourage someone else to do this, and maybe they're not ready, but maybe they'll be ready, you know, a few years from now, if you can at least do something to change things for the better, that's all we can ask. And as far as being perfect, what was that thing that they used to say, a woman has to be twice as good or something yeah. as a man, remember that, to do any job? And yeah, we women, that's why Hillary, Trump comes out with names. She's a liar, she's a this. And she doesn't come back and call them names because we can't do that. Through bitches, those are the words you used. And that's why there are very few women comedians, because we can't say what men can just say and get away with. And we have to watch ourselves and be ladylike, or we're going to be just. And it's a very hard road to walk, you know?
You know, something else Zephyr had said that stuck in my head, too. She said, it's not disrespectful to challenge somebody in a race. You know, and that's a pretty female thought, to think, you know, it's confrontational and it's uncomfortable to say, I think I could do a better job than you. Who says that? Not really women out loud.
Is there legislation that you can put through Congress that would sort of equal the playing field? What do you think it would be? And how would it be implemented?
Pass the ERA. Equal Rights Amendment.
I think that some of these issues that some of the women the stories I was relaying work on are so important around economic independence of women, which is really so, which I feel like from the perspective that we have at the Veach program and then the kind of organizing and issues that women are facing, that economic independence and access to fair wages, safety in the workplace are so important. So something that seems so impossible, you know, just a few years ago, that there could be something like a $15 minimum wage, which now is becoming a reality in cities and in states around the country, that is really about people taking to the streets, demanding of their elected officials, and putting campaigns together piece by piece by piece. And, you know, we're still talking about a minimum wage that would be, you know, phased in over the next few years. But right now, the minimum wage is a little over $7 an hour. So that's that kind of thing, I think, that seems really like so far in the future, and also maybe not about my particular situation, has such significant impacts, I think, across both in terms of people's day-to-day lives. But I think the other thing that it does is it shifts the balance of power. It says that people in fast food jobs, people, young people, people of color, women, can push labor unions and establishments, can push elected officials, and can win things that will really have a direct impact. So I think that's an example. I don't know if I had to pick one piece of legislation, that would be the only one. But I think it is a really significant kind of a movement and a momentum that we're seeing that really does have very strong effects, is very much driven by people who are most directly affected, and is something that's, I think, really hopeful in a really kind of a bleak time, you know? I think that, you know, when we talk about, whether we're talking, I think, about a glass ceiling or being able to go to your minimum wage job, somebody's got to watch your kids, you know? And somebody's got to watch your elderly parent, or somebody has to watch the person in your family that needs medical attention. And so I think that those are the kinds of issues that become like women's issues, but they're life issues. And I think, you know, we know that, organizers know that, who work on multiple issues. The leadership of it is often by women, for women. But I think those are the kinds of issues, again, that are really significant. And they become almost like the throwaway issues, but they really do impact on people's lives. And I think the other one, it's interesting because I think Sanders really, you know, initiated the the conversation about this, and now Hillary is picking it up, which is access to debt-free college, or, you know, a free college education. In the work that I've been doing over the last few years, I worked a lot with community colleges and community college students who were like just, you know, smothered in debt to get an associate's degree because of all the scamming that goes on with for-profit colleges and not being able to transfer credits. And it's just, you know, the depths of these kinds of issues and the impact that it really has on real people every day is really profound. And so I think, you know, I think as we more engage in a real dialogue after next Tuesday about what does our country really need, I feel like those are the kinds of issues that are now in the public debate, you know, on the docket for candidates that we can all play a role in. They are so important. They impact people every day. And again, I think we can change things, and there's lots of evidence about that.
You look at the brutality that Hillary is taking from that buffoon. I mean, she has to be a very tough, brave woman. This is frightening for any woman who really wants to run. How could you meet somebody?
That's the whole purpose of the game.
Well, no, you have to. I think she has to have special characteristics to be an awfully tough, brave woman. And what she's going through, and this has never been, I've never in my lifetime seen anything like this. Is this what's happened when a woman wants to run? Would this happen if Hillary was a man instead? Would she be taking such brutality?
Nope.
That she's going to be impeached? That she's a horrible person by a buffoon? And this is allowed? What kind of world is this becoming? And this is a very brave woman. And a very, very tough woman. And how many women have this characteristic? That can withstand such withering criticism from such a horrible person. Well, I don't
think so.
I mean, you really have to think of something like this.
That's a big factor. That's a big factor.
You know, one of the things that I saw even in my brother's local elections, well, my brother ran for Congress against Peter King in 2006. The low level that it gets to is really appalling. I mean, just talk about the issues. They don't just talk about the issues. I mean, at one point, my mom woke up, she had Peter King stickers all over her car. I mean, this is like the type of nonsense that, you know, as a woman, as a mom, I don't want to deal with that stuff. I don't want to deal with, you know, even if there are rumors or there are accusations of things that are false of my son potentially seeing that and thinking that it's true or later Googling his mom, those are factors that we're not talking about issues. We're talking about personal nonsense that is not appropriate. And they're red herrings that kind of just attract the voters and get them excited instead of thinking about the competence of the candidate. Of their qualifications, of what their platforms are. So that's a very big factor, I think, for women. For most people, I think, like, good people don't want to run for office because they don't want to deal with this stuff. That's why, like, half the people who run for office, you either have to have really thick skin, you have to really want to do good things and be able to deal with whatever it is, or you have to be a crook, because good people, they get turned off by running, you know, especially local school boards.
Going back to economic independence, there's a film some of you may have seen called Girl Rising,
yes,
which is sponsored by an organization that believes that by educating girls around the world, that it will help many, many situations, because the mothers, if they have an education, then we'll be able to see the need for it for their children. So I recommend, if you haven't seen it, that you see it, because this was in Port Washington where they showed it, and there was a woman there who happens to be the representative of the Afghani population on Long Island. I did not realize there are 30,000 Afghani people living on Long Island. And she said, to my horror anyway, that many of the Afghani families send their girls back to Afghanistan to get married. And that they try to stop this, or, you know, they can't stop it, but they try to educate them to block it, because many of you know what kind of life many of them will be leading. They go back to Afghanistan and get married. So educating women and fighting for women's rights in this way, I think, is a very important thing.
Have any of you heard about the talk about a guaranteed minimum income? I've been hearing about it on NPR lately. There's more and more talk about to get rid of poverty, which is such a problem for women and children. And if there was a guaranteed minimum, this is really Bernie Sanders, I guess. Well, it's not Bernie. I think it's taking him another step. But I thought it was very interesting that it's even being discussed. And I was wondering, what do you think about it, considering, you know, all the things that young women face?
Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up, because I think that is really, really cool. And it's, you know, and again, I think it's a really good example of the kind of thing when I was a young organizer in New York City and somebody would raise their hand in a meeting and say something like that, it's like, oh, it's like the lefty, you know, talking about the impossible, you know. But now there's real discussions and real analysis of the economic implications of a guaranteed minimum income. And it is really about compensating people for the work they do to keep our society. And it's the shift in my lifetime as an organizer is like profound. And so I think, again, I think, you know, we see, I mean, I'm talking about in terms of the perspective that I'm offering here around women who run organizations, have 501c3s, raise money, run campaigns. But at the same time, we're at a time of such powerful social movement where people are taking the streets, you know, and really speaking out about racial justice, about economic justice, about climate change. So I think, you know, while we're in this, you know, such an important moment in terms of the election and the electoral life of our country and, you know, the potential for a woman to be president of the United States, I mean, this is my daughter's life. You know, I have teenage daughters and a woman is on the ballot in their life. And that is really, you know, no matter what anybody may think of the candidates, that's really different than how I was introduced to politics as a teenager, you know? And so I think it's just so important to not be discouraged by the vitriol of the campaign and to know that there is amazing work that's been going on all over the country, here on Long Island, in New York City, and that, you know, with so many of these issues no longer being like the fringe issues, but things that people are really claiming and studying and putting forward, I think there is a tremendous opportunity ahead of us. And so, you know, I really look forward to more discussions, you know, here at Shelter Rock and elsewhere about how we could each play a role in that. Because it's you know, and you know, and part of that is that when women decide that they want to run for office, that they don't feel like, you know, the fringe case or the isolated woman who's going to get out there and get beat up if she says something wrong or if she doesn't look good the day that she, you know, is on TV. Do you know? And so, like, and so I think it's really the, you know, one of the core concepts that we talk about all the time is that, you know, we're to get power together, you know? So I think that if you look at the fabric of our politics, I think we have a lot to feel very hopeful about.
I'm not really like looking to run for any like executive or legislative office, the judiciary. So my goal is to be a judge, and we need more women on the bench. So I know that we don't directly affect policy, but case law makes a difference. And, you know, for instance, I was in the matrimonial center for 7 years doing family law, and there was a case that we had. We wrote a decision, which ultimately was used to affect change of maintenance laws, temporary maintenance laws. So the judiciary is very important, and women bring a very different perspective to the bench. And not just in, for us to sit in family court, which is also very important, but we need women in all levels of the judiciary. Right now, Judge DeFiore, she's the presiding chief of the Court of Appeals, and it's only good things to have equal representation on the bench, too. So I just want to emphasize, you know, a lot of people kind of drop off on the ballot when it comes to the judicial candidates. So important to, like, do your research and to think about who you're going to be putting on the bench, because that affects everybody every day.
Thank you, everybody. And if you give us some applause to our speakers. Thank you.